We did it! We finally broke even on the installation costs of our grid-tied rooftop solar panels. We now have a power plant on the roof of our house supplying electricity literally for free to our house, as well as powering our transportation with our Tesla Model S. The first question you're likely wondering is, how long did it take? Everyone's situation is a little different, both in the costs of the installation and in the amount of electricity their panels can produce, based on a variety of factors. I outlined all of the costs and details of the initial installation of our 6.38 kilowatt solar array in this video, which I'll link to in a card above. We were able to achieve a relatively cheap initial installation by doing most of the work ourselves, but also starting with a smaller system, then expanding it. Our solar adventure began back in early 2017 when a door-to-door salesman brought to my attention that the local electric utility was going to be changing their solar net metering policy, probably sometime that fall, and that their proposed change would be much worse for the homeowner. After some initial brief research to verify what he told me was true, I then looked into the current pricing of solar panels and inverters. I found that the prices had come down significantly over the last several years and were much more doable than I had previously thought, especially with the state and federal tax rebates currently available. The initial quote from the door-to-door salesman was for a 4.64 kilowatt solar array, which he stated was for 90% of our historical consumption and came to a total system cost of $17,632, but after tax credits would bring the actual price to $10,342. Having such a discount due to tax rebates really brought the price down within reach and is what really piqued my interest that sent me down this path. Their total system cost of $17,000 translates to a price per watt of $3.80. Naturally, I wanted to know what other companies would charge, so I asked Vivint what they would charge per watt, and they said between $3 to $3.50 per watt. I then filled out a form with SolarCity, which is now Tesla, just asking for their price on a 5 kilowatt solar array, and they estimated $17,000, which comes to $3.40 per watt. The 5 kilowatt system size was based on my research of how much electricity we had used over the prior 22 months that we'd lived in our home. Our average consumption was 584 kilowatt hours per month, or about 7,000 kilowatt hours per year. Based on calculations for our latitude and region, it looked like 5 kilowatts of solar panels is what we needed. That means our system would cost roughly $15,000 to $19,000, not including tax rebates. I researched the actual cost of the equipment involved and found that this system size of just the hardware would cost closer to $8,000, so I was kind of shocked at the price markup these solar installation companies charge. I recognize that they have to get paid for their labor, but marking up the price double seemed excessive to me. Being discouraged by the labor prices and knowing that we didn't have the cash to install solar panels at that time, I decided not to install solar on our house. However, knowing that the net metering policy was going to change in a bad way kept nagging at me, so I started watching YouTube videos on how to install solar myself. After lots of videos, I thought I could probably do this myself, but I wanted to have someone willing to help me if I got stuck on any part of it. I managed to find an electrician willing to work on an hourly basis on any part of the installation I wanted him to do. That gave me the confidence to proceed, but put me at the risk of project overages instead of the electrician. During the solar system design process, as I was calculating the size of solar array we needed, I realized it would be really cool to be able to power an electric car from our solar panels, and perhaps I should oversize the array a bit to accommodate that increased energy consumption. That sent me down a rabbit hole of researching electric cars, and frankly, I've never emerged from that rabbit hole. In short, though, I did size the system to 6.38 kilowatts, which according to my calculations was enough energy to power a Nissan Leaf round trip to work every weekday. At the time, we owned two vehicles, and we decided we could get by with one for a while. So I sold my 2011 Hyundai Sonata 2.0 liter turbo, then used that money to purchase the initial $7,000 worth of equipment. It took me a couple of months of work before and after that equipment purchase to get the permit approved, then install the rooftop components, and I had the electrician replace the main service panel on the side of the house, as well as install the metal conduit, since that's tricky and requires specialized tools I didn't want to purchase. That entire system, including the labor of the electrician, permit fees, engineering letter, and all the hardware, was $12,408, or $1.94 per watt. After tax rebates, it was $6,685. That system worked great for 2 years, and I absolutely loved seeing our electric bill reduced to $10 a month for the net metering fees, and no power was on the bill because solar was powering all of our needs. That system went online in August, and by February the following year, I received the tax return money, which included the rebate for the solar installation, and I immediately purchased a used Nissan Leaf from our local classifieds. I loved driving it to work knowing it didn't cost me anything, and it turns out there was free charging at work, so we had excess energy available at home. Clearly, I saved a lot of money by doing it myself, but it cost me hundreds of hours of time researching and learning how to do it, then ordering the equipment, dealing with the city to get the permit, installing the equipment, and dealing with the electrician and inspectors, all of which was stressful. In hindsight, all that work was very worth the stress and months of work. I had a lot of family and friends ask me about my solar installation, and that's the reason why I created one of the first YouTube videos here on my channel that I linked to at the beginning of this video, reviewing all of the details and costs. There were some other videos I made to share additional insights and findings, and ultimately that door-to-door salesman was the spark that started my whole solar, then electric vehicle journey that I have now made many videos about. In my initial EV research, I had found that clearly a Tesla was the best option. But being budget constrained, my second best option was the Leaf, and it worked great as a commuter car, but not for a whole lot else due to its minimal range. My next financial goal was to upgrade to a Tesla, and I continued to watch their used prices closely, as well as research which model I wanted as my goal. I decided my target price was $40,000, and I decided a Model S85D with rear-facing seats was the model I wanted to be our primary family car for around town and road trips. I found just such a Model S in early 2019, which was a year earlier than I had anticipated, and I documented this story in its own YouTube video, which is linked to in this card above. We've been extremely happy with our decision to purchase our Tesla, and it's still our primary family hauler to this day, 4.5 years and 70,000 miles later. Since the Tesla has significantly more range than our Leaf, it also consumes more electricity. So that was the motivation behind our solar expansion in mid-2019, increasing our rooftop solar to 9.98 kilowatts, which I outlined in this video, which I'll link to in a card above. Both systems combined cost me $9,735 after subtracting the tax rebates. Up to this point, for my family, the plan had been to get an SUV, most likely the Model X someday, and use it to pull a small trailer for the occasional truck need. Then I discovered that there was an aftermarket hitch I could install on my Model S, so I installed that, and it has served us well towing our small utility trailer when we need to haul things larger than would fit in our Tesla. We've also used it to tow our small fishing boat. I'll put a link in the description below to our Tesla towing playlist of videos. In late 2019, the Tesla Cybertruck was unveiled, and after I recovered from the shock of its appearance, I realized that was the next electric vehicle I wanted because it combined the utility of a truck that I wanted, but with the much better efficiency and lower operational cost of an electric vehicle. I reserved one the night of the unveiling, not knowing how I was going to afford it, because even though it was announced to be cheaper than I expected, it's still more than we've ever spent on a vehicle. In fact, our Model S is the most we've ever spent on a vehicle. When I was a kid, my family never had a truck, even though we really could have used one. We heated our house with a wood-burning stove, and every year we would pull our trailer down to the woods with our van to load it up with wood that we had cut out of our forest. Because of this, it's just never been in my mindset to own a truck due to their high operational costs, and in my experience, most people actually use them as a passenger vehicle the majority of the time. We started saving for the future Cybertruck expected to be 2 to 3 years away, and in the meantime, I realized if we were now going to have a truck, we would have the means to pull an RV trailer. Both Jessica and I have camped regularly our whole lives, but neither of us have ever had much exposure to RVs, as we only tent camped. I liked the idea of expanding the camping season that an RV enables, as well as being able to go on long distance trips, basically bringing our accommodation with us. Being able to do this with a more efficient EV appealed to me, as well as being able to share the electricity either direction between the truck and the trailer. While waiting for the Cybertruck, we purchased a Lance 2185 travel trailer in November 2020, and over the next year, I installed 2,650 watts of solar panels on it, plus 9.6 kilowatt hours of batteries, dual 2400 watt inverters, and other modifications that completely removed any use of propane from the trailer. See the card above to the playlist of all our adventures to date testing out our trailer. That project consumed all of my spare time for a large portion of 2021, and my goal was to finish it by the end of the year, which I barely squeaked in a win by having all systems operational on the last day of the year. That goal was somewhat influenced by the stated Cybertruck ship date Tesla had originally announced, but alas, it was delayed. Due to that delay, we went ahead and purchased a 2014 Ford F-250 so that we could make awesome memories traveling with our trailer now. We rarely use the F-250 for anything other than towing our RV because it's costly to operate and not very pleasant to drive compared to our Tesla. Anytime I can tow our small utility trailer with our Model S, I'm able to drive nearly for free. The electricity is free from our solar panels, so besides the general wear and tear on the car, the biggest cost is 2.89 cents per mile of tire wear, which has been our average over the last 70,000 miles. And for what it's worth, our Tesla is just infinitely more enjoyable to drive than the lumbering, lethargic truck. Now that I've caught you up with our story, I'll show you how I calculated the break-even point on our solar installation. It's not as straightforward as it would be as if it was just a simple flat rate. They charge different prices based on blocks of energy per month. The first 400 kilowatt hours consumed per month is billed at a low rate. The second 400 kilowatt hours is billed at a medium rate, and finally above 800 kilowatt hours is billed at the highest rate. I didn't want to build an Excel spreadsheet with all of the block rates. Also, I wanted to calculate my break-even point based on the averages in Utah instead of getting too specific with my exact situation. I looked for a generic average for the state of Utah where I live. In the beginning, I was calculating based on a simple flat average of 10.95 cents per kilowatt hour that I had found on a report from the government. Then I found another website that had 10.97 cents as the state average, and finally on that site I found the monthly price average for Orem, Utah, which is the closest reported city to where I live. I copied down each of the monthly average rates into a spreadsheet, and I used that price against my own production to calculate the monthly value of the electricity my solar panels were producing. Based on that flat rate of 10.97 cents per kilowatt hour, we broke even on October 1st. Based on the 10.95 cents per kilowatt hour price, we broke even on October 5th. And based on the Orem average monthly calculations, which average out to 10.79 cents per kilowatt hour, we broke even on October 17th, 2023. I think October 17th is likely the most accurate calculation, and that comes to a grand total of 6 years, 2 months, and 3 days to break even. For a while, I was tracking the amount of electricity going towards charging our electric vehicles so that I could calculate the value of that electricity based on what the cost would have been to fuel a gas-powered car the same distance. Ultimately, I decided that that was too much effort, so I abandoned it. If you consider how expensive gas has been at times over the last 6 years, it's quite probable that we actually broke even a lot sooner. I know some of you are thinking, well, just because our solar panels produce the electricity doesn't mean it's electricity that we would have consumed and thus had to pay for if we didn't have solar. The way our net metering agreement works, our excess kilowatt hours roll over month to month. But in March, if there's still excess, our net metering balance is reset to zero and we are not paid for it. So I am motivated to use it or we'll lose it. To that end, we have two different demand levers that work well to increase or decrease our electricity consumption as we approach March each year, with the goal to break even right when our bill comes due. We don't want to leave any energy on the table, but we also don't want to pay for any electricity if possible. Our electric utility company doesn't make this easy because they don't reset the net metering balance on the same day each year. In fact, it has varied by 5 days over the last 6 years. The two best demand levers are charging our Tesla and heating our house with a 5.6 kilowatt electric space heater. The space heater is the most convenient demand lever because it can use a lot of energy if I leave it on continuously, or I can just leave it off and let the natural gas furnace do its thing. Plus, it directly offsets an expense. the Tesla can save a lot of energy depending on how much we drive. And frankly, we mostly just drive however much we want to drive. Before I got the space heater, sometimes we'd go on a regional day trip for fun, but also somewhat motivated by the excess solar energy we were going to lose if we didn't use it. We certainly still go on adventures, but the timing is less motivated by the impending net metering balance being reset in the spring. Someday I'd love to install a heat pump to heat our house with, and then our excess electricity would go farther due to the efficiency of heat pumps. But I'll wait until our curtain air conditioner compressor gets to the end of its life. There have been some times when the net metering balance is running low, so I charge our Tesla for free at local superchargers, but I avoid doing that because it's less convenient than charging at home, and supercharging is harder on the Tesla battery. The end result of these efforts is we nearly perfectly consume all of the electricity that our solar panels produce. This dynamic has changed through the last 6 years as we have expanded our solar array, acquired electric vehicles, and built out the solar array on our RV. In fact, for much of the year, I charge our Tesla from our RV solar panels, which I'll link to in a card above. So that has caused our net metering balance to get higher than ever before. The most energy we have left on the table or lost in 1 year was 387 kilowatt hours, or $42 worth of electricity. The total we've lost over all 6 years is 652 kilowatt hours, or $71 worth of electricity. That means out of the 89,432 kilowatt hours our panels have produced over the last 6 years, that we haven't used 0.7% of it. The average amount of energy lost per year has been 109 kilowatt hours. We've had to pay for a little bit of electricity when we have run negative 7 times over the last 6 years. That amount of electricity adds up to 965 kilowatt hours, or $106 worth of electricity. The most we have had to pay for in 1 month was 361 kilowatt hours. The closest we've been to breaking even at the end of the net metering balance was within 18 kilowatt hours of zero. The highest net metering balance we've accrued was actually just recently on October 30th, 2023, at 3,087 kilowatt hours, which is partially due to now having the RV solar panel production, but another big reason is we replaced our clothes dryer with a heat pump that uses significantly less electricity than our old dryer. Prior to our RV solar panels, our net metering highs were typically around 1,200 kilowatt hours. The topic of grid-tied solar is not straightforward due to the significant variance of net metering agreements, installation costs, and power requirements, but I hope this information is helpful to see how it has worked out for us. Solar panels typically have a performance warranty for 25 years, but they're likely going to continue producing a significant amount of power for 50 plus years with a small amount of performance degradation annually, like in the order of 0.5% per year. The average power production per month of our 9.98 kilowatt system has been 1,355 kilowatt hours. Based on that average, our solar array will produce an additional 317,287 kilowatt hours after subtracting the kilowatt hours needed to break even, which at 10.79 cents per kilowatt hour is worth $34,235. If they last for 50 years, that's an additional 724,008 kilowatt hours or $78,120 worth of electricity. It's possible individual panels may fail over the years, but what's far more likely is I will just replace the whole array to upgrade the technology. I replaced the roof with 30-year shingles 8 months prior to installing the solar panels, so that's most likely when I will replace the solar panels. One last thing. In my system, I installed a string inverter paired with power optimizers under each of the panels. Power optimizers are more robust than microinverters, so the component that will likely need to be replaced in 25 years is the string inverter, which is warrantied for 12 years as a point of reference. Up to this point, for the first 6 years and 2 months, there have been zero component failures and zero maintenance. If you also have solar panels, I would love to hear your own break-even timeframes, or if you haven't broken even yet, how long you estimate it will take. With that, thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.